Frank Sinatra and Count Basie. They go together like peanut butter and jelly. A magnetic, iconic duo that people still remember today. Fly Me to the Moon, Sinatra and Basie. Pennies from Heaven, Sinatra and Basie. The theme from Mondo Cane, Sinatra and Basie. A lot of your favorite Sinatra songs are from Sinatra and Basie. While they only collabed on two occasions, that being on An Historic Musical First, and It Might As Well Be Swing, people still remember a lot of Sinatra and Basie songs because of how unique and how powerful the sound was. But what if I told you that another legendary jazz crooner paired with Count Basie? You'd probably say, nah, Jeff, you're pulling my leg. What if I told you someone as big as Bing Crosby? What if I told you that it was Bing Crosby? You'd probably be even more surprised. But you don't have to believe me. You can just look at the evidence. Unfortunately, I scoured the internet. I said this for my Hey Jude Hey Bing video, but it goes double here. I scoured the internet, and I was barely able to find anything, any notoriety, barely anything. This album has been forgotten by, I guess, everybody. So I have found it my job as the historian of YouTube to educate you guys about this forgotten collab. Why is it forgotten? How was it forgotten? And most of all, did it deserve to be forgotten? Now, imagine it's the year 1972. Who are you listening to? Perhaps the Carpenters? The Rolling Stones? Who? Or John, Paul, George, and Ringo separately? Since they had broken up by this time and were starting their radical solo careers, ones that would not quite reach the magic that the Beatles had achieved. Now, I didn't mention Bing Crosby in that list, because at this point he was fading into obscurity, and doing so rapidly. He knew this as well, so he decided to make it a point of his to boost himself back into relevance, which he had already tried to do with Hey Jude, Hey Bing, as well as somewhat with Thoroughly Modern, with the younger audiences. With Thoroughly Modern being for the really young audience, and Hey Jude, Hey Bing being for like the teenage audience. Neither of these worked, especially the former being Hey Jude, Hey Bing. Since no one wanted to hear Bing Crosby sing a Beatles hit or Puff the Magic Dragon. That was not really a market. So, Bing decided to try to boost himself back into relevance with the older adult audience. Ones that still appreciated jazz standards, yet were starting to come around to all of this Beatles music. So, he decided to collaborate with someone who'd always had a good career and never had any slumps, with that being Count Basie. Now, Basie agreed to do the collaboration and recorded his orchestra, pre-recorded it before Crosby did the overdubs, for 3 days in February of that year. And Crosby did his takes on March 14th, 15th, and 16th of that year, if we're going to be specific. Now, Sammy Nestico did the arranging for Basie's orchestra, creating that classic Basie feel since he was known for his Basie arrangements, as well as Oscar Peterson played the piano for this album, and he was again known for his works with Count Basie, therefore boosting the recognition of a Count Basie album and creating that classic Basie sound. Now, essentially, this is a Basie-driven album with Crosby vocals thrown in, but that happens to be the key part for Crosby, especially, since he knew of Sinatra and Basie's works and decided to replicate that same success. Now, Crosby chose 11 jazz standards, and I do say chose, I emphasize that, since according to Johnny Mercer, who also had a small hand in the album, Bing did a, quote, great job choosing the 11, quote, wonderful jazz standards. And Mercer's not wrong, they are decent jazz standards, with an addition of one new one on the album written by famous jazz standard writers. Now, Bing released the album, as well as Basie, and it came out to actually good critic reviews, with people complimenting Basie's orchestra work, but mainly targeting Crosby's voice, since they knew, as well as everyone else, they examined the elephant in the room, that Crosby was doing this for recognition. And they said that his voice was better than it was 40 years ago, with 40 years ago being the 1930s, when he could sing Old Man River and hit all those high notes. But they said it was better now. They preferred the more mellow, deep Bing voice because it showed more emotion, feeling, and resonance. Now, as well as the album receiving good reviews, it also received good fan reviews. But it slipped under the radar simply because of other stuff happening at the time. People weren't interested in Bing Crosby, which completely isn't his fault, and wasn't at the time. But the album completely slipped under the radar, and ergo cannot be listened to on any streaming services today, and has to be bought as a used vinyl on Amazon, or listened to on YouTube unofficially. Which is what I had to do in order to listen to all the songs in that album. Which is exactly what I did for you guys. I'm going to give you a little background information about the song itself. I'm going to give my personal thoughts on it. And I might also give my personal thoughts on the original version of the song. So sit back, relax, and you'll find out if this album really deserved to be forgotten. Now, the first song on this album, Bing and Basie, is the hit most famous by Glen Campbell, Gentle on My Mind. Now, this song was originally written and released by John Hartford, courtesy of RCA Records, and would become popular immediately with a multitude of artists covering it, including Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Glen Campbell, who, as I mentioned earlier, had a hit with his version, with it reaching the top 30 and becoming a staple of country music today, and Bing Crosby. Now, coming into this album, I had extremely low expectations. Hey Jude, Hey Bing really disappointed me and off put me from Crosby's work, especially following that, not preluding it, of course. And Crosby's age also off-put my expectations. But the recording that I listened to, from the album, of course, was fantastic. I was extremely shocked, and my jaw literally dropped when I listened to the song. It was phenomenal. Count Basie's orchestra lifted that song up so high. I didn't realize how bad Jimmy Bowen's orchestra was until I listened to Count Basie's orchestra. That is how a jazz standard should be done. Crosby's vocals were on point, smooth as always, and Basie's orchestra was unreal, and the two combined so well, like peanut butter and jelly. Sure, Sinatra and Basie were fine, but so far, this album was off to a fantastic start, with I being very shocked by the extraordinary performance by Crosby and Basie. Now, the next song on Bing and Basie is the Ray Stevens hit, written, composed, produced, and performed by him, Everything is Beautiful, appearing on many of Stevens' albums and promoting a religious message as well as an anti-racist message. Beautiful song with a beautiful message, definitely very influential, and is performed in many religious events. Many people have covered the song with the likes of Jim Nabors, whom you may know for playing Gomer Pyle on the hit television show aptly named Gomer Pyle USMC. But today we are looking at Bing Crosby's version. The first song was good. Did this one disappoint? Absolutely not. Count Basie's orchestra was as good as always, and Crosby, after having a little bit of a rough start with that first song, had that signature Bing phrasing that we all know and love, creating a silky smooth Crosby rendition of Everything is Beautiful, which may musically surpass the Stevens one by a mile. Although Stevens one is heartfelt and touching, the Bing Crosby one I could actually put on my Spotify playlist and keep on listening. It was fantastic, and everything was on tip-top shape. I would definitely put this track on my playlist if it is available on streaming services. Unfortunately, however, it is not. Now, the next song on this list comes from the 1961 musical Stop the World, I Want to Get Off. No, it's not the Sammy Davis Jr. hit What Kind of Fool Am I? It's actually one of his other hits, Gonna Build a Mountain. A very catchy song. I listened to the Sammy version first, just to hear what it'd be like, and it was really good. So then I switched over to the Bing version, and that was excellent. Again, another great song to add to this album, with Basie's orchestra really going wild, especially during the musical break, with the saxophone player really going crazy there. I was sort of surprised and taken aback by how extreme and how over the top Basie's orchestra could get. And Crosby nails the key changes in the song. I felt myself vibing along, as well as being swayed by the music. And I was really quite amazed. Key changes are hard to pull off, but Crosby pulled it off just like he could 40 years ago. Now, the next song on Bing and Basie is perhaps the most famous song on the album. Not performed by Bing, but just most well-known otherwise, from the musical Fiddler on the Roof. No, it's not If I Were a Rich Man, but Sunrise, Sunset, which has been performed by a motley of artists, including Perry Como, Robert Goulet, and Matt Monro, among many others. Now, Bing's version is actually good. Sunrise, Sunset is a hard song to perform well because the song itself isn't really the greatest musically written song of all time. But Bing does it well, with it surpassing my expectations, and of course Count Basie's orchestra living up to my expectations, with them working together like that peanut butter jelly combination. And overall, just really good listen. Not as good as the other songs on this album, but still really good. Crosby's vocals were a little off, though, with him having to clear his throat at the beginning of the song, but nonetheless, still a great recording. The next song on Bing and Basie is actually an original composition written by Johnny Mercer and Sammy Nestico, titled Hangin' Loose. If you look online for this song, you won't find any information on it, as no jazz singer has covered it except for Crosby, and the album that it was on simply didn't sell well, therefore not creating much notoriety. Which is a shame, because I believe that making presumptions, due to the lack of information, that this was the album's selling point, noting that you'd get a bunch of jazz standards with this album, covered jazz standards, and then this great original piece written by Johnny Mercer, a prolific writer who'd been dormant up to that point, due to his lack of hits. Now, this didn't work out, which is a shame, because you can hear in the song within the lyrics Mercer's figurative language and superior poetic wording that no one else seems to use. And Crosby does it well as Basie. They work like that signature peanut butter and honey or peanut butter and jelly combo that we all love. It's a fantastic song, signature Johnny Mercer lyrics, but it just simply didn't work out. And that's because of the lack of sales on the album. Overall, I believe that if this album had gained some more sales, Hanging Loose is a jazz standard we'd still be talking about today, and had that standard been released 20 years earlier from that point, it would have been a massive hit for a jazz crooner. The next song on the track listing for Bing and Basie is titled All His Children, a song originally performed by Charlie Pride and Henry Mancini, and was in the Paul Newman film, actually was the theme song for the Paul Newman film, Sometimes a Great Notion. Crosby is the only notable cover of this song, but despite that, it still reached number 2 on the country charts. I listened to Crosby's version, and it was good. It was sort of standard, though. He didn't really put much of his own twist on it, and it sort of sounded like he phoned in the lyrics, but I still genuinely enjoyed it, with it being a fun listen, and Basie's orchestra being as powerful as always, and it being a solid addition to the album, starting off the latter half of it. Next song on Bing and Basie is one famously performed by contemporary gospel singer of the time, Anne Murray, and written by Gene McLaughlin, Put Your Hand in the Hand, a song about Jesus. Bing Crosby performed a version of the song, and we all know he was a devout Catholic, and he really conveyed it in the song. He put a lot of power into the vocals, hitting a high note at the end that I wasn't expecting, along with Basie's orchestra swinging doubly the amount they were in the previous couple of songs. I was amazed that the album could actually take an upward turn like that. I was truly taken aback and really befuddled. Overall, I was really impressed with that song, Put Your Hand in the Hand. And if there was one that I wanted on the streaming services, it would definitely be that one. Now, proceeding from that, the next song is another Anne Murray hit, also written by Gene McLaughlin, Snowbird. Now, Snowbird is very similar to Put Your Hand in My Hand, at least the way Crosby and Basie do it, as I seem to have noticed by this point that all of the songs in Bing and Basie are pretty similar. However, that doesn't mean they're still not good, but at this point it was getting a little repetitive, and Snowbird just sort of seems like all of the other songs. So overall, while it was still good, it might have been diminished by the fact that there were no minor songs in the album, and that they were all cheery, almost at the same tempo, groovy, Bing Crosby, almost scat rhythm songs. The next song on Bing and Basie is the track Little Green Apples. I'll cover the song's history a bit deeper in my Hey Jude, Hey Bing video, so if you want to know a little more behind that song, definitely go check that one out, as Bing also recorded the song for that album. Now, obviously, this was a different version for this album, and I must say, comparatively, a better one. Even though he removes the main verses, which really fill in the context of the song, it's still, like, listenable, unlike the Hey Jude, Hey Bing one. The loss of the verses does affect it a little bit, though. The second last song on Bing and Basie, being the 10th song, is a song written by famous 40s and 50s lyricist and singer Peggy Lee, Sugar, Don't You Know. Now, it's an original song written just for this album, just like the Johnny Mercer song I mentioned earlier, but this one wasn't included on the A side and was rather included on the B side, which I think was a missed opportunity, since this ballad is actually really good and is a nice change of pace from the other 9 swinging songs. And it was really refreshing, and got to hear Bing really smooth it out with the ballad setting, and Basie's orchestra adapted just as well as you'd think they would, just as well as they did with Frank's orchestras. And there's also a Fred Astaire reference in this song, which is, I believe, only the second reference regarding Fred Astaire since A Nightingale Sang in Berkeley Square, which was written back in the 40s. So they sort of ironically looped back Fred Astaire all these years later, of course, relating it to dancing. This song is really good, and I'm glad that it's here, because it's a nice change of pace from the upbeat swinging songs from earlier. Although, I find it sort of strange that it isn't the last song on the album, if it's not on the A side. It's the second to last, so we're gonna have to see which one's the last one. To close out the fantastic album, Bing and Basie, the Sammy Nestico and Johnny Mercer song, Have a Nice Day, is performed by Bing Crosby. Not to be confused with the Bon Jovi song or the Stereophonic song. This is strictly a Bing Crosby version of the song. Completely different composition. Now, I wouldn't say that this should have been the one to close out the album. I would say that the ballad should have closed out the album. But this is a fine song. Definitely not one to leave you off with. Because it probably would have been better for the middle of the album. Overall, I really liked it, though. And it's a good way to just round things out, even though the ballad would have been better in its position. And that was Bing and Basie. I was shocked by how good this album was, especially since Hey Jude, Hey Bing was so bad, and would definitely recommend a listen for anyone out there who's curious. Any Bing fan, any jazz fan, any Count Basie fan, or just any music fan in general. It's a good album. There's nothing that you can't like about this album. It's really good. And I hope you're excited for next week, because while we may have started off with a good topic this week, some of you may remember Dean Martin's Matt Helm. And if you do, you're going to be excited for next week's upload. Stay tuned for next Friday.